So this is Dr. Vijay Kumar. Again, coming back to the memory unit of computer organization. So last time we have discussed about the simple memory structure and its organization, and also the cell unit of a memory we have discussed. And this time we will look into more in the memory structure, how it can be organized for having larger memory size. So one of that could be, we can say, the static memory systems. So connecting memory chips to form a much larger memory. For example, suppose if a question comes to design a memory of 2 mega words of 32 bits each. So by using a one single memory chip, that is 512 kilo into 8 bits smaller size static memory chip, how we can organize a memory of larger size having 2 mega words and 32 bit each. So this organization I could explain by writing a diagram shown. So here you consider that a single memory chip having 512 kilo into 8 bit each. It will have 8 data lines. To address 512 kilo memory locations, we need 19 address lines. So in order to configure, organize a 2 mega words of 32 bit memory, we need to consider 4 rows and 4 columns of memory chips, and totally there are 16 memory chips. If you connect this memories, so there are data lines each having 8 bit and 19 address lines in order to access the memory locations within 512 kilo, that is 2 to the power of 19, which is equal to 512 kilo memory locations. So we could able to locate them by using 19 address lines, 19 bit address lines. But the design is to have 32 bit output data lines. So in order to get 32 bit, we need to connect such 512 kilo 8 bit, 4 such memories can be connected in a row like this. We can connect, and all the data lines are taken from this 512 K memory 8 bit are taken like this, and the data lines are taken, and these data lines are bidirectional. And if you connect 512 like that, if you connect 4 such rows, 4 such rows, so it will form 512K, 512K and 512 kilo cross 8 such, and each one is connected with these address lines. And also these address lines are connected to the address lines of this, address lines of this. Like that, every 512K, each memory is connected with this 19 bit address lines. And in order to access the output, that is 32 bit output, so we need to take these in a particular row, we have to enable all these complete row by enabling this bit, which can be one of the address line. Like that, there are four rows, so we need to enable the different rows as and when we want to access the particular memory location in a particular row. So we are going to use these two address lines and these nine address lines. All together there will be 21 address lines which can access up to the location of 2 to the power of 21, which is a 2 mega. And once if the particular row is enabled by using higher 2 bits, that is the bit address bit A20 and A19, and from here A0 to A18 will access the memory location within 512K, and these two address lines are used to access all the four rows, sorry, here by using a decoder, that is 2-to-4 decoder. And this decoder will have four outputs, and these four outputs it will be connected to every row, and this row is connected to every chip of this, and chip select of this particular row is connected. So the whenever this higher 2 bits are given 00 input, I'll write it clearly. Two to four decoder. Whenever 00 is put on this address, these two address line, it will select the zeroth row, and all these chips will be selected. And in order to access the particular memory location within this 512K, we are going to provide A0 to A18 address on this line, which will select correspondingly the location. And since the complete row is enabled, the data, 8 bit data of this will be taken as D31 to D, it is written there. Yeah, so D31 to D24, and D, you can read that slide, D23 to D16, 8 bit each, and D15 to D8, and D7 to D0. So that whenever the address is given, the first higher 2 bits will enable the particular row, and remaining address lines will enable within the memory location of that particular row. And the data, whether we do read or write operation, depending on the control signal which is provided to this each memory. So each memory will have, as I discussed in the earlier class, each memory will have a control signal, read or write, and when the read operation is done, the data in the particular location will be output on these lines. So that in total we are going to access 32 bit word at the output, having a total location about 2 mega. So we are going to achieve the higher memory size by using a smaller memory, that is 512K into 8. We can organize the memories of different size and to have the capacity corresponding to that particular computer memory requirement. So this is the structure of large memories as an example. And normally we do the choice of the random access memory chip is based on the speed, cost, size and power dissipation. Normally static RAM are fast operation and it is the primary requirement, and dynamic RAM implementing larger main memories reduces the frequency of access to the secondary slow memory. This means to say is you can access the secondary memory, we can access the secondary memory at a slow rate as compared to the main memory. So we are going to organize the different memory size requirement depending on the program, depending on the speed and depending on the requirement of particular system we design. So therefore the memory module that contain assembly of several memory chips are plugged into a single socket on the motherboard using single inline memory module or double inline memory module package technology, so that it will occupy less space on the motherboard. So this is a simple organization of the main memory. So the different examples were given that uses number of pins on the socket that will be plugged into the motherboard, that is 4 mega into 32, 16 mega into 32 and 32 mega into 32 bit, which uses 100 pin socket for example. And coming to the other, how does this memory controller works whenever we connect the memory to a computer? So let me write a simple memory controller which lies between the main memory and the processor. This is processor and the memory controller and the actual memory which we are going to connect, either static RAM or DRAM. Usually the processor will give the address of the memory where we want to access, that is address, and also it will give a request and whether there is a clock and also read write and request, it is written there. The controller forwards, these are all the address lines. What is the necessity of controller? The controller used to control this memory by accessing the different rows and columns of the memory, and that will be gives rise to the multiplexing of this address lines, so that we can send both row address and column address by multiplexing on less number of lines by using this address lines, and also it will generate row enable, that is RAS, column enable store, which I explained in the previous class, and also read write and chip select, and as usual synchronous clock is required. And these data lines coming from the processor are directly connected to the memory unit, either we can read or write. So memory controller, the data lines are connected directly between the processor and the memory. So one important thing is we can multiplex the address lines, which we can have few address lines here, so where we can latch the row address and the column address by using this RAS row and address strobe and column address strobe. So this is the simple organization of a memory controller in a DRAM, and also it will have the refresh. Memory controller has a refresh counter that provides successive row address and need when used in DRAM chips. We need a refresh circuit as I explained in the previous class. There is another memory organization wherein normally when a memory is connected, most of the time we look at the latency and the bandwidth, and here along with the access time of the memory, we also have the other time which is taken, that is the signal transfer between the processor and the memory. The signal where it transfers through the transmission line where we connect the processor to the memory. So this has to be avoided. This can be done by using a signal level which represents zeros and ones with a small swing, voltage swing. So this is one of the example, that is a RAM bus memory, and which is very much useful for to avoid the wired buses and also expensive and which requires a lot of space on the motherboard. So in such cases we are going to use the less connecting lines, and these connecting lines will swing between 0 and 1 with a voltage supply with a small voltage swing, that is around 0.3 volts. Here it is given. So we take a reference voltage 2 volts and two logic values are represented by 0.3 volts swing above and below the reference voltage, so that the swing of the voltage, reference voltage, will be very small, so that the transmission time can be reduced. And this is one of the structure that is RAM bus memory provide this facility, and this type of signaling is called differential signaling. And here it is, short voltage swings leads to short transmission times, high speed of transmission, and reduces the transmission time. Necessary to design special circuit interface to deal with differential signals. And RAM bus provides complete specification called RAM bus channel, and presently we have got 400 megahertz and both edges of clock, if you consider, it is 800 megahertz. RAM bus require specially designed memory chips, that is dynamic RAM technology, and circuitry needed to interface to the RAM bus DRAMs. And normally RAM bus channel has got 9 data lines. 8 data lines are used for normal data transmission and one for parity check, and also control lines and power supply lines. There are two channel RAM bus, direct RDRAM, and 18 data lines, 2 byte of data can be sent. And normally the communication between RDRAM, RAM bus RDRAM, and the memory, that is processor, it takes place with three types of packets, that is request, acknowledgement, and data, which will request for the memory access. And when we receive the acknowledgement from the control unit, then data transmission takes place. Sometime when the memory is busy, it may also send the negative acknowledgement. And RDRAM can also be assembled into larger modules, that is 16 RDRAMs, just like previously I explained, 512K into 8 bit memory can be used to configure 2 mega into 32 bit memory. And SDRAM is an open standard, but RDRAM, RAM bus, is a proprietary design which we have to pay royalty for every usage and design of such memories. And so far we have discussed the different memory and how we can enhance the size of the memory. Now coming to the read-only memories. So the read-only memories, so far we have discussed about static and random dynamic RAM, wherein when the power is removed, the content of the memory is lost. But most of the time in a computer needs to be stored permanently. Simple thing is, whenever we want to perform initial operations like loading operating system into the main memory, the initial instructions are to be executed, and those initial instructions normally has to be stored in permanent memory, so wherein the data is not lost even the power is removed. Such type of memories are read only memories, where we can store the data permanently. And this type of memory, normal operation involves stored data, and only we can read the content of the memory. The special, that ROM, normally its circuitry is shown here. It contains a transistor, a memory cell consists of a transistor and a connection, that a connector point here, a point at which if it is shorted, it is connected to the ground. That means we are storing a bit 0, and if it is open, it means we are storing a bit 1. So it is explained here, when the T, that is the transistor, close, the voltage drop to 0, no current between T and ground, bit line remains high and 1 is indicated. So this is a simple structure of a memory cell unit. And next, another read only memory structure, programmable read only memory, where we can store the data into the memory. User can program it as and when it is required. When he brings, he can program it once, and this programmability achieved by inserting a fuse at point P. In the previous circuit, at point P, if a fuse is introduced here, so the programmer can either burn the fuse. If he burns the fuse, it will store the 0, that is logic 1, and if it is not burnt, it will be logic 0. And we cannot reprogram it in case of programmable ROM. And these are faster and less expensive and can be programmed by the user. This is the advantage of PROM, programmable ROM. Another read-only memory is electrically programmable ROM. ROM chip allows stored data to be erased, erasable and programmable ROM, sorry. And the ROM chips allow stored data to be erased and new data to be loaded, and capable of retaining stored information for a long time. That is the advantage. And memory changes and updates can easily be made. And here it uses a special transistor, wherein the transistor at point P, as I showed in the previous figure, at point P a special transistor is stored at this point, connected, And this transistor can be made to conduct, and it can also be made stop conducting by program, by using storing a charge in the transistor. And that transistor, when the charge is trapped into the transistor, it will stop conducting, and if you remove that, it will be open circuit. And erasable program uses special transistor, that is, data is erased by dissipating the stored charges by exposing to ultraviolet rays through windows. The entire content of the EPROM will be erased. So this here, the one of the advantage here is we can also program as and when required, and also erase the content of the memory. So this is one type of ROM. Another ROM is electrically erasable programmable ROM. In this case, we can use electricity to program and erase the content of the ROM. And one of the advantages is we can erase only on selected cells. In the previous case, if a memory is put under the ultraviolet rays, all the content of the memory will be lost, that is, erased. And in this case, it erases only on selected lines. But only disadvantage is it needs different voltages for erasing, writing and reading the stored data. Similar to this ROM, there is another type of memory which we call flash memory. Based on a single T transistor controlled on trapped charge, as I previously explained, we can charge the transistor and make it enable or disable, and correspondingly the data is stored 0 and 1, and can read the content of a single cell, but only possible to write the entire block of cell, that is, one can read the content and can be possible to write entire block of cells in a flash memory. And advantage is greater density, which leads to higher capacity and a lower cost per bit. That is one advantage, and requires single power supply voltage and consumes less power in their operation. And normally these flash memories are used in MP3, music player, digital cameras, cell phones, etc. Larger memory, that is, flash cards and flash drives are also used. And these flash cards are mounting flash chips on a small card plugged into a slot in a memory. And sizes, it can be 8 MB or 32 MB or 64 MB. And normally we use, but these are all very much old values. Recently we can go up to 1 GB flash, 2 GB, 4 GB, which we can store lot of information, and we use it for so many entertainment and also store so much of huge information in the present day. And replacing the hard disk, which we use normally, can also be, we can use flash drives. And the storage capacity, now it is increased very much to 40 GB when we can use flash drives, and recently they have come. And one advantage is shorter seek and access time and faster response. And low power consumption is one more advantage. And insensitive to vibrations. Normally hard disks are very somewhat sensitive, but these are all insensitive to vibrations. Cost is higher per bit. But one more disadvantage is we can read the content of the disk as many times as possible, but the data will not be deteriorated. But in case flash, after reading several number of times, the data gets deteriorated. And now coming to the organization of the memory in a given computer, that is, which we consider the main parameters in any computer is this regarding memory is the speed, size and cost. So we need to access the data which is stored in the memory as fast as possible, because the processor speed is very high as compared to the memory access time. So therefore, we configure different hierarchical structure in the memory. That is, there are two level of processor cache, that is primary, located on processor chip only, and the secondary placed between memory cache, between primary cache and rest of the memory, which we call that as a level 2 cache. And level 1 cache is stored in the processor chip itself. And here it is a simple configuration which you can see here. The processor, the high speed memories with less size, that is resistors, which we use so many resistors in a processors, and the primary cache within the processor, and the secondary cache, and main memory, and the magnetic secondary memory. Here we can look at these parameters, the size, speed and cost. So as we increase the size, so the direction is shown. The size of the cache, primary cache is less, secondary cache still more, main memory still increases, and huge magnetic disk. But the speed, as we it decreases. So as we go towards the processor, when we keep inside the processor the cache, the speed is increased. So this configuration says that the cache are very fast memory, and also the cost increases, but the size decreases as we increase the speed. So normally, as I said earlier, the speed of memory is very less compared to the speed of processor. Cache memory makes memory appear to be faster than the other memories. And effective of cache mechanism is based on a property called locality of reference. What is locality of reference? There are many instructions in localized areas of programs are executed repeatedly during some time period. So most of the time when the program is executing, and most of the functions and procedures are repeatedly called. Such repetition and repeated instructions can be accessed frequently, and also we can analyze which part of at what time we can access these memory content, that instructions or data repeatedly accessed information, and we can also find such references so that we can preload, that means we can preload such information into the memory cache so that execution of program speed increases, and we call this as locality of reference. There are two things here, that is the spatial and temporal. The spatial is the instructions which are in close proximity to a recently executed instruction with respect to the instruction addresses, and are also likely to be executed soon. So that is spatial. Instead of fetching just one time from the main memory to the cache, it fetches several times, it fetches several times that reside at adjacent addresses as well. This will reduce the access time, and block reference refers to a set of contiguous address locations of some size cache block line. So that you can access the information contiguously and also at a fast rate. Another one is temporal. A recently executed instruction is likely to be executed very soon. Whenever an information item, an instruction or data is first needed, this item should be brought into the cache when it will hopefully remain until it is needed again. That means time dependent, so that we can recently and repeatedly accessed information can also be used as a temporal information, so that we can access such information fast. So this is one more advantage. So therefore we go for locality of reference, so that easy access, fast access can be done. And here the read operation from the cache we do like this. The block of word from the memory to cache, and one word at a time we can read. Program references any of the location in this block, and desired contents are read directly from the cache. That will be very fast. We can access the information at a faster rate. Correspondence between memory block and cache is called mapping function, so that the physical address given by the processor should be correspondingly mapped into the cache content where the word is supposed to be accessed and it is in the cache. There are mapping functions which are defined, and we are going to use, when a cache is used, the main memory content will be loaded into the cache, and those content which you store in the cache, the processor, when the processor gives the address on the address line, and those address has to be properly mapped so that the word is available in the cache. And suppose if the word is not available and the cache is full and we have to access the memory word, and which is not there in the cache, and we have to use the cache control hardware, and should decide, that hardware should be decide which block should be removed from the cache and create a space for new block that contains the referenced word and a collection of rules, and we have to use such rules to make this decision which block of data in the cache are to be replaced with the main memory content. And that is done by using replacement algorithm. And there are different types of replacement algorithm which I will discuss, it will be discussed soon. Read and write operations are addressed to locations in memory. Cache control circuit determines the existence of the word in the cache. So whenever it looks for the word in the cache, if word is present, then read or write hit. That means we are hitting the right word in the cache, so that the access will be very fast, and we call this as read or write hit has occurred. For write operation, system uses two methods for write into the cache. So write through protocol, what it means is, whenever you want to write something into the cache updated, in the write through protocol, both the content of the cache and the main memory, the same block which is copied into the cache, are updated simultaneously. But another protocol uses write back, that is, update only cache content, the particular word which is supposed to be updated, and mark it as updated with the associative flag bit. That the word which is updated, associative flag bit is attached to that particular block, and we call this as dirty or modified bit, so that the modification has occurred in the cache block of memory block content. The main memory is updated later when the block containing the marked word is to be removed from the cache by replacement algorithm. When the address word in a read operation is not in the cache, a read miss occurs. That means we are missing that data, that word in the memory, that is cache. So therefore, what we do is the block of words from the main memory is copied to cache fully, and then requested word is forwarded to the processor. This is one method. The alternative method is a word may be sent to the processor as soon as it's read from the main memory. When you are copying from the main memory into the cache, so as and when we copy the block of content, that is a block from the main memory into the cache, we can immediately pass it on to the processor, and we call this as load through or early restart. So these are the two techniques we follow when there is a memory miss when read operation, during read operation. And when we want to write operation, when the particular, if the address word is not present in the cache, to write a miss, a write miss occurs during this time. If write through protocol is used, update information in main memory directly. So if you use write through protocol, it uses directly update the information in main memory. If write back protocol is used, the block containing the addressed word which is there in the main memory is first brought into the cache, and then desired word in the cache is overwritten. So normally this kind of operations, read, write, write miss and read miss, if it occurs, how best the mechanism is followed so that the access of the particular word of interest can be, always it will be in the cache, some or the other way, or if it is, there is a miss, how we plan to take it into the cache and try to update and rewrite or update also in the main memory. This is a small description, and students can understand here, this is just a mechanism wherein the cache, which is a fast memory and can access the information at a faster rate, and from the main memory we take portion of the main memory content as a block, and these blocks are executed, the content of this block will be the instruction or data. Whenever a processor requests for a particular word, it will give the address, physical address, that is memory address, and this will be correspondingly mapped onto the cache memory content if that block is present in the cache. And how do we map it? So there are mapping function. How will we access the content of the cache from the address given by the processor? So there are three techniques we follow, because here you can observe, suppose for example this is the cache and this is main memory, and cache can store a portion of this memory content, or it can be any portion of the main memory, we can load it into the cache so that the processor can access directly the cache by giving proper address. And when we are accessing, whether the program, the memory content, whatever it stored, when the processor access the particular content of the memory, whether this particular word is present in the cache or in the main memory, which we discussed earlier, there will be read or write. If it is there in the cache, there is no miss. If it is not there, there is a read or write miss occurs. In such cases, we need to correctly map the word which is supposed to be accessed by the processor, so that the particular word will be accessed, whether it is in the main memory or in the cache. So when it is in the cache, we have to properly map the address given by the processor onto the cache memory address. So this is one of that. There are three methods. One is direct mapping. It is a mapping to determine the cache locations to store memory blocks. In this case, you can look here. So this is the main memory, and this main memory, which is around 4,095, 4K blocks are there. And suppose if each block is of 16 words are present, and this cache, which has got 0 to 127, that is 128 blocks it can allocate, it can store. And here in direct mapping, the block and that is 128 blocks are directly copied from the main memory from 0 to 128 127, and the second set of main memory content is 128 to 255. So it can store up to there, the next slot it can store. Suppose in case, if the block that is stored, that means since it is 4K, so 127, so many such transfer can occur between cache and the main memory, and which block goes to which block location in the cache, it is shown here. That is block 0 goes to block 0 here, and it can also store block 128 to 0. That means to say, the block that is stored, block I of main memory onto block J, modulo capacity of cache in blocks, that is I is equal to J modulo M, that is cache block number and main memory block number. This is the main memory block number and the number of blocks in the cache. So this will give the which block will be stored at which block location in the cache. And one more important thing here is, how does the main memory address is mapped onto the cache? As I said earlier, this direct mapping will map the address using this main memory address by grouping the total bits. Suppose if it is a 4K, which can be accessed by using this total number of bits, here it is. So 7 plus 4, 11, 11 plus 5, 16. So much of memory location it can access. So each of, that is 2 to the power of 16, which is 4 into 16, 64K memory location it can access. And each block is of 16 word, and these 16 words we need 4 bit, as I mentioned here. So if you have got 4 bits, we can address 16 different words within the block, and these bit identify unique word byte within a block of memory. That is 4 bits selected one word out of 16 words of a block, and block 7 bits block field so determines the block location in the cache. That means, so there are 128 blocks within the cache, therefore within this cache 0 up to 127, So it can be which block we are going to access. That is, the 7 bits represents, 7 bits block field represents the block location in the cache. The higher order 5 bit of the memory address of the block are stored in 5 tag bits associated with its location in the cache, which identify out of 32 blocks that are mapped onto the cache location or that are currently reside in the cache. That means to say, this block, this complete set might have been stored, or next might have been stored, or next, like that. So many 128, that means to say 32 such kind leads to 4094, that is 4095. And which of this group it is been stored in the cache, that will be taken as the tag. And since there are 32 such block, that is a group, which we store it into the cache, that the cache size is 0 to 128, that is 127, 28 such, if you divide, so it will come to 32. So therefore, the tag size, we require 5 bits. Therefore, whenever a processor gives the memory address, which is a 16 bit address, and each bit, lower 4 bits represents the word within those 16, within the block, and which block out of 128 we are going to select, and also 5 bit, the which tag is attached, which block, that the total 0 to 127 or 128 to 255, so which block of the main memory has been stored in the cache. So this is direct mapping. So the problem here is the block 0 can only load 0 block of main memory, 128 of the main memory. So there is a restriction in this direct mapping. So therefore, that restriction can be overridden by using associative mapping, which there are set associative mapping. So the different mapping I will try to explain in the next class. So now, today we have discussed about different memory, how we can increase the size of the memory, and their organization, and also we looked into how the RAM bus, and how is the hierarchical structure of the memory, and also different cache memories, and replacement algorithm, and mapping function, which is only direct mapping. HREC, Nidoshi. So you could ask me some questions. You could ask me some questions if you have any doubt. Next mapping section I will take up other two mapping, but you could ask me now some question. Over. Yeah? Any questions? Lakshmeshwar? No. Lakshmeshwar College? Thank you. Okay, thank you very much. Conclude. Yeah. So, next time we will look into the other mapping, associative mapping and set associative mapping, and also more into the virtual memories in the next memory organization. And thanks. Thank you very much.